Now coming to the monetary policy response, and you know that the monetary policy, there are limitations to tackle a recession or a pandemic, because the only policy tool available to the monetary policy authority is the repo rate or the policy rate. So maneuvering the policy rates, if it is not one-to-one in tackling the economic growth, then you won't get the growth story correct. So when there is a partial response by the monetary policy authorities to the growth recovery, fiscal redominance is quite crucial over there. And on the top of that, you know, countries have to respond to how, you know, Fed Reserve, you know, they are going to change their monetary policy stance, because that global arena is very important, because beggar thy neighbor, you know, that kind of policy, if it is maneuvered by the Fed Reserve, then that's going to be detrimental in the growth recovery process in the emerging economies. In the sense, US Fed Chair Jay Powell has specified in the recent Jackson Hole Economic Symposium, because students know that this is the economic symposium we look forward to understand the, you know, articulation of how the monetary policy stance of US Fed is going to respond. So in the economic symposium, in the Jackson Hole meeting of 2021, and also in the Federal Open Market Committee, it is like our monetary policy committee in India, in the FOMC meetings, you know, there was a clue that there was a likelihood of tightening the US monetary policy stance. They are going ahead with reducing their balance sheet. And what is the repercussion of that? There could be a possible rise in the, in the policy rate in early 2022 by the US government. So the repercussions will be on the emerging economies. And you know that there are fragile economies like Brazil, Turkey, India. So how they are going to tackle this process? And if we don't increase the interest rate, then what will happen? The capital flight will happen, because a part of our capital, our foreign capital, is portfolio, that's hot money. And hot money always responds to, you know, the high interest rates. So unless we increase our interest rate, RBI doesn't increase interest rates, then, you know, there can be a capital flight. And of course, if you look at the imported inflation, the global variables like energy prices, and of course the food prices are shooting up. If you look at the inflationary process as well, you know, we are not in a comfort zone. Our inflation is beyond the comfort zone. How I define the comfort zone? You know that, you know, let me give you a perspective. We know that in 2016, Government of India and RBI entered into an agreement, and that is called the New Monetary Policy Framework. And as per the New Monetary Policy Framework, price stability was the only concern, is the only concern of RBI. So inflation is their mandate, and this inflation is again based on a rules-based monetary policy. Rules in the sense, a Taylor rule is not written in that monetary policy agreement, but that inflation targeting, which is, you know, that pegging the interest rates, the policy rates, based on the inflation anchor, inflationary expectations, and the output gap. So that is quite crucial. And here the inflation anchor we have designed for India is 4%. And of course, we have the comfort zone of plus or minus 2. So literally, if it is above 6%, then we are technically beyond the comfort zone. But the articulation by RBI is that these, you know, rates above this comfort zone is just a transitory phenomenon. We don't have to worry about it, because it happened due to, you know, supply chain disruptions, and also due to the temporary things that is happening at the energy prices. So things will be all right, because it's not a demand side inflation, because we know that there are supply side economics functioning as a part of, you know, economic growth process or economic pandemic packages, but the demand side is not yet stimulated, and the demand side policies are not yet, you know, taken place. When I say about the demand side policy space, the major thing what we anticipated was like a huge fiscal transfers to the hands of people, cash transfers into the hands of people. It's not like a helicopter money, but, you know, a targeted cash transfers into the hands of people. But that has not happened in our country. The articulation by North Bloc is that, you know, there is no guarantee that this is going to trigger, you know, demand. Instead, if the propensity to save by the people is higher than, you know, the propensity to spend, then, you know, huge cash transfers also cannot trigger, demand recovery. So that was the argument. Then, you know, the next option is the employment policy. You know, when we are in a pandemic period, how the government can act as an employer of last resort by guaranteeing jobs, because this is participation income, that you participate in the economy and earn an income. But if you look at the allocations, you have seen that the job guarantee allocations were coming down, because, you know, if you are unable to find jobs, then you articulate that as, you know, no money is transferred in the hands of people. So maybe a kind of policy maneuvering over there is required, that even if you are unable to guarantee jobs for a certain number of period, that cash can be transferred in the hands of people as a cushion, you know, instead of designing a separate cash transfer programs. So in addition to the government acting as an employer of last resort, and in addition to the targeted cash transfers, there are four important components which you need to give emphasis. And one is, you know, your social protection measures. In India, we don't have, you know, significant social protection measures. You know, that's a crucial point. If you unpack the economic pandemic packages all over the world, the social protection measures, you know, that is not quite, you know, what you call significant in the pandemic packages. And the second point is the food security. And we have seen in the recent, you know, the global hunger, you know, that index have come out, and India is not doing well. And food security is an important issue. And nutrition, you know, giving importance to the nutrition aspects, you know, these are important issues. And we need to give a huge space, even at the subnational levels, we need to give a huge space to the food security concerns in the time of pandemic. And the third is, of course, the education. We are facing the digital divide right now, and whatever we have attained in terms of the enrollment, you know, that is not a story right now. If you adjust for the digital divide, then the enrollment rate, that's plummeting like anything. So we need to tackle that digital divide process. And the fourth, that's quite important component, is health. Investment in health is quite crucial, and that's a single most significant, you know, investment that has to happen right now. But we have been, you know, maybe erring on the side of caution, that we don't have fiscal space, and we are keeping the health budget to GDP, you know, around 1% of our GDP, not even 1%. So whatever that preparedness is required to vaccinate, because if you look at the fiscal monitor of IMF and the World Economic Outlook that was published in this month, October, you can see that, you know, the countries in which you have that public health infrastructure so crucial, and the countries which have succeeded in, doing the vaccination process, you know, they are able to control the pandemic much better than, you know, the other parts of the world. So there is a clue over there that it is primarily a health crisis, and we need to spend a huge amount on, you know, health sector infrastructure, personnel, and vaccination. You know, that is much more crucial than investing in any other sectors. But, you know, if you look at the pandemic packages, in the life versus livelihood, that was not the way, you know, it was given importance. And of course, it was not a simultaneous process. It was a sequential process in the way we have addressed the livelihood concerns. And that is yet another, you know, the policy, that constraint, what has happened on the fiscal side. Now coming back to the monetary policy side, I mentioned about the global challenges. One is the capital flight that can happen because of the US Fed Reserve raising the interest rates. And second is the imported inflation and the inflationary process that's happening globally. But at the same time, the dilemma of RBI is that we cannot increase the rate of interest because that will affect the growth process. So in this dilemma, they have given importance to the growth concerns and kept the repo rate status quo at 4%. But the story doesn't stop there. You know, the other policy instruments available to RBI is reverse repo rate. And if, of course, you need to look into the monetary policy corridor. They have nudged, the commercial banks to, you know, go ahead with the lending process in the economy by maneuvering this policy corridor and adjusting that space between the reverse repo rate and overnight, you know, that marginal lending facility rate. But right now, you know, there is a news or there is a tendency all over the, you know, all over the world by the central banks to go for normalization procedure. In the sense, whatever excess liquidity they have announced to tackle the pandemic crisis, slowly they are absorbing that excess liquidity. And there are concerns about excess liquidity in the sense, the call money market, the rates are below the repo rate. And we also have repercussions on the GSEC, the gilt-edged securities market. But if you look at the numbers, in spite of RBI nudging, you know, the commercial banks to go ahead with the lending process, there is a tendency for the, you know, commercial banks to park back the amount into the RBI. So that's a reverse repo rate. And that reverse repo rate was kept at 3.35%. Even then, that's happening. And recently, all what I can see is that there is no normalization procedure by the RBI. All what they have done is they have gone into a tightening process of just the variable, you know, repo rate. That is that's the cutoff yield. If you look at, that's now 3.99. Otherwise, they have not announced in the recent meeting, in the October, early October meeting, about a hike in the what you call the reverse repo rate as well. Now the story doesn't stop even there. It is not about the reverse repo rate or the repo rate that, you know, the entire story of a monetary policy stance. Of course, we have done the mistake in the sense, India has gone ahead with inflation targeting framework since 2016. And as per that, we are, you know, by mandate only to look into the price stability. But when the pandemic hit our country, you know, if you look at the policy announcements, we have gone prior to the new monetary policy framework. We have had many announcements related to liquidity infusion and even the regulations, the way it used to happen prior to the new monetary policy framework. Because inflation targeting itself, you know, some of the scholars in front of me, young scholars, can look into this question whether that itself must have led to, you know, low growth rate in the country, because, you know, that one-to-one process of repo rate and the GDP, that does not happen like that. So the reverse rate that failed to trigger the economy, or why the story is partial, that we need to you know, take a look. That's one thing. And second, how countries responded to a crisis. In 2007, we had global financial crisis. Now there's a pandemic crisis. In 2007, you know, if you look at, of course, no crisis or no, you know, recession is, you know, followed by a quick rebound. We are not going to get a quick V-shaped or a U-shaped recovery. Rather, it will be K-shaped because of the inequalities, widening inequalities in our country and in, you know, other emerging economies. That is very crucial. The second point is like, the credit story. What we have emphasized in the pandemic package is the credit story, that credit deployment is going to give a growth boost. And we have not touched the fiat money because the fiscal space is quite limited. So articulation by many economists, including Professor Kaushik Basu, you know, Professor Abhijit Banerjee, and even industrialists like Kotik Mahindra, what they're arguing is, like, can we increase the fiscal space using the fiat money? But it was a huge debate. And of course, my director, you know, Professor Pinaki Chakraborty, has spoken to the Press Trust of India regarding this, that there is a danger in going for fiat money at this moment because it can lead to fiscal profligacy. But at the same time, he mentioned that two macroeconomic variables are quite crucial over here. One is the real rate of interest, and the other is the real growth of economy. And if your real rate of interest is greater than the real growth of economy, then of course you have to go back to your fiat money or synergy financing of your deficits. But till then, you know, it's a kind of free lunch, but you are comfortable in the sense that you grow out of debt. You may have high debt, but how the debt is sustainable? Because you grow out of it. Your G is greater than R. So that's a point. But if the R is greater than G, then you have to think about the innovative sources of financing, the deficit, to get the fiscal space to tackle the pandemic, because monetary policy space is limited. Repo rate or the reverse repo rate or the liquidity infusion or the credit offtake, these, there are limitations in triggering the economy through that process. So the fiscal dominance is quite relevant. Fiscal dominance means we have to get our fiscal space correct in the time of revenue uncertainties. So center government and the state governments, they have gone ahead with innovating the fiscal space. For instance, center government has given emphasis to the privatization proceeds. And of course, we know that only one thing that has happened over the last 1 year is the aviation sector, that little bit of privatization has happened. But otherwise, the valuation process, the pricing process, the labor market repercussions, all these are quite important the moment we go ahead with privatization. And it is important to look into this process, not just from the fiscal proceeds perspective. Second point is, even from the fiscal proceeds perspective, if you look into the recent Union Budget 2021, you can see that the privatization proceeds is just, even if your aspiration is correct, that is just around 6% of the entire revenue receipts, if you look at the revenue and the capital receipts. So if the fiscal marksmanship is perfect, if you are going to get, what you aspire as the fiscal proceeds, the fiscal space from the privatization, if even if that marksmanship is perfect, then it is only about, you're talking the story about 5% of the entire revenue receipts budget. So that is a way center government is emphasizing to increase the fiscal space, because other is revenue uncertainties. Revenues are getting buoyant right now, but these high frequency fiscal data we cannot depend on. Of course, there is a clarion call to look into the real-time analysis of fiscal marksmanship, then only we will be able to avoid the bunching of the revenue and the expenditure towards the March, towards the end of the fiscal cycle. So that real-time collecting of the fiscal marksmanship analysis is quite relevant, and that is an important tool of PFM, public financial management. But that is not it happened. We have to wait and see how it is going to be rolled out in our country. Now, coming back to the monetary policy side, I mentioned that normalization procedure is not at home. We are grappling with the policy dilemma that unless we increase the rate, that could be the capital could be flighty, the hot money could be flighty, and the inflation process, that's a concern. But we kept it at accommodative stance, not even neutral stance, accommodative stance at 4% over the various MPC meetings to get this goal correct, that is our growth recovery. But the story now goes beyond the MPC meetings. Monetary Policy Committee, their mandate is looking into the repo rates. Even the reverse repo rates, they are not able to maneuver correctly. So what is the constraint of that operational independence of the Monetary Policy Committee? That is crucial to look. And it has gone ahead from, the monetary policy decisions taken by RBI governor to a committee. Now the voting process is on. It is through an operational independence. But of course, we don't have the goal independence, but we have the operational independence. At the same time, it is not the story of center bank independence, because in this macro policy setting, macroeconomic framework, if you look at, fiscal policy has always been the first mover and the monetary policy follows. So that is always there. But the moment I argue for the fiat money or for the synergy financing, then that fiscal redominance is given importance. And why Government of India is not going for that? It's not from the perspective of the technical R&G macro variables, but from the hysteresis perspective. Because over the years, we have controlled the fiat money, the synergy financing of deficit, and we have gone ahead with the bond financing of deficit. So once again, if you open that fiat money, that space, then what's going to be the fiscal profligacy, what is going to be the repercussions? But I have written about it, that a finite fiscal space through monetization of deficit, not assets, of course, monetization of deficit is crucial, in the sense the alternative is we don't have money, we have to go for austerity measures. So that expenditure compression in the time of pandemic can be quite detrimental. for growth process and for the growth recovery. So what's an alternative? Then, you know, that's why I was arguing for a finite monetization. But, you know, we have to see the big picture. What Professor Pinaki Chakraborty was arguing is that the moment we open up this instrument, when it comes to the question of fiscal marksmanship, if you're not getting the tax projections all right, and what we projected and what we realized is not matching, if there is an issue of fiscal marksmanship, would it open to open a floodgate for an adjustment through the fiat money the way it has happened in the late 80s? So that is a concern. So otherwise, if it is can be tied to an employer of last resort policy or to a targeted cash transfers for a finite time, a finite MFFP, money financing a fiscal program, then, you know, that is, I think that, you know, that can be thought of, but you know, North Bloc has not yet, you know, decided that from a point of strength because of the fiscal profligacy which it could trigger. So that's the concern. All what has happened is they have owned the statement that deficit is good in the time of pandemic. If you can articulate that by enhancing public investment. Because, you know, investors' confidence will not get affected if you have high debt in the time of pandemic. The moment you can articulate that from the point of strength for of enhancing the public investment. Because if you look at any empirical models, it is the public investment that's a crucial determinant for private corporate investment. No other variables. So here, the clarion call is to keep your macroeconomic fundamentals all right, including the fiscal deficit. But, you know, if you keep on doing that macroeconomic fundamentals, including the fiscal deficit, you know, to the 3% of GDP, then, you know, it is going to be a little tricky because you won't get the growth all right, because monetary policy is partial in doing that. So it's a policy dilemma. That's what is happening, because, you know, on one side, you need to tackle the plausible capital outflows in case Fed Reserve increases their Fed policy rate. So how to tackle that? We have already done capital controls and we found that it is not effective. And we have already intervened in the forex market to, you know, the stabilize the currency, but that is also not a permanent solution. When those things are not permanent, the second thing or the biggest option is work out your macroeconomic fundamentals, whether it is current account deficit, whether it is inflation, whether it is fiscal deficit. That's why the importance of the macroeconomic fundamentals, you know, that is quite crucial for the foreign capital. So it, you can understand the policy dilemma that's happening, right? On the one side, we are unable to increase the you know, rate of the policy rates because we fear a repercussion on the growth recovery. On the other hand, the fiscal dominance, you cannot control your fiscal deficit because that is also will affect your growth recovery process. So in this, theoretically speaking, we have two options. One is unpleasant fiscal, you know, arithmetic option, and the other is unpleasant monetary policy, you know, option, arithmetic option. So unpleasant monetary arithmetic is you give importance to the fiscal policy makers, the first mover advantage, and the monetary policy follows. Here, there is no question of central bank independence. And here the question, unless your R is greater than G, you are comfortable. But if your R is greater than G, the monetary arithmetic is going to be unpleasant because you have to eventually monetize your deficit. And on the other hand, unpleasant fiscal arithmetic is you're giving full independence to the center bank, and the center bank will be the first mover using the repo rate. But there, you know, you can understand that even the policy rates, you know, that cannot control inflation, because inflation is not strictly a monetary phenomenon in our country. What are the other kinds of non-monetary factors from the supply side? You know, all these things are quite relevant. But the way RBI defended that is like through expectations channel. You know that inflationary expectations is an unobserved variable, but through the expectation survey, they created this variable, and through that expectations channel, you know, even the supply side components can be controlled in the process. So these are the ways in which, you know, this is getting controlled. And these, if the students are interested in reading about this, the fiscal theories of price determination, that's the recent work, the recent school of thought, because the moment we talk about price determination, you know, it's an irony. How can it be fiscal? But there is a fiscal route or the fiscal theory to the price determination process. Of course, they also believe in, it's a Chicago school of thought, they believe in, you know, pegging the interest rates to tackle the inflationary expectations and the output gap. So you can take a look into it. And I want to open the floor also. So my last point is the output gap. These are times of macroeconomic uncertainties. And you know how you measure this macroeconomic uncertainty. RBI and, you know, North Block, we have depended on an unobserved variable, that is output gap, to deal with this process. And what exactly is this tough variable output gap? That's the difference between your potential and your actual. And your potential is, of course, it's an unobserved variable. It's difficult to capture. And using, you know, econometric methodology, we captured, you know, I have spoken to my students, you know, earlier also, like you take out the cyclicality component and you call the trend as your potential. So that's the way it is done. But, you know, there's a problem over there, and it's a highly controversial topic the moment we talk about the output gap, because you must have read in the works of Geeta Gopinath of IMF, chief economist Geeta Gopinath, her paper with Mark. That title of the paper is Cycle is Trend. Take a look into that paper, because you know these are not temporary aberrations. What's happening as a growth downturn, it's not cyclical. This is going to be a permanent scar unless you work out your structural elements. So the moment fiscal policy and monetary policy act as a counter-cyclical policy tool, then you are dealing only with the cyclicality elements. And you think that the moment you correct your cyclicality, then you're going to get the growth prior to the pre-pandemic levels. But that may not happen, because a structural, you know, the productivity, the structural issues are very important to deal with this crisis. And I stop here and look forward to your questions and comments. And over to you, Professor Ramankutty. Thank you so much.